What up, paintball fam? My name is Carl Markowski, and you are listening to the Playing On Podcast. Thank you for joining me. We are proudly brought to you by Planet Eclipse, the makers of the LVR, which I shoot on Chicago Aftershock. That thing is sweet. We also are shooting the CS Pros, which are the new CS1 or CSRs, really. But they're only made for the pro teams, and you have new fancy milling and graphics and everything. Those things are hotcakes. But I shoot the LVR, not because I'm special and I like to shoot those little things, but it's a special little niche market. But I love the things. I love egos, and the LVR is the epitome of an ego. So thank you to Planet Eclipse for sponsoring this podcast. Also brought to you by Midwest Clothing, where you can get all kinds of custom gear for your team, such as pants. They have some sweet Tiger Stripe pants over there. They have a jersey deal going on, along with a headgear deal, where you can get all kinds of custom graphics. They can even do it for you for a very, very cheap price. If you head over to MidwestClothingLLC.com, you can find all of that cool information over there. And if you type in capital TPOP at checkout, that is where you can get a sweet 20% discount. So thank you to Midwest Clothing for sponsoring this podcast. We are also sponsored by Vantrition, where you can go over there and find at Vantrition.com, you can find all kinds of paintball supplements, such as the preload, the paintball preload, the paintball reload, which is a pregame kind of get your jets going little supplement, as well as the recovery formula, which you take after the match, after the games, whatnot, and it kind of, you know, mends everything. I'm actually taking a tendon recovery formula from them that they're in the works of producing now. They give it to a lot of the pitchers for their arms, but I'm using it for my knee. But it's been working great. I love it. You can find it all at Vantrition.com. And if you type in capital TPOP at checkout, you will get a nice 15% discount. So thank you, Vantrition, for sponsoring. Also brought to you by Carbon Paintball, Chicago Aftershock, the awesome pro team that I play for. We are sponsored by Carbon, and we wear their base layer, which means they're under protective layer, which is like a compression fit shirt and pant, but it also has padding built in different spots. Like the undershirt has padding for your elbow pads, and the underpant, which is what I wear, has knee pads built in, as well as like hip slide pads and a little bit of shin protection and whatnot. But I've never really been a big fan of them. I am now, ever since wearing those. The knees stay in place. It's nice and tight, but it's not too constrictive. I love those things. I can't say enough good things about those pants. Those are awesome. You can find it all at carbonpaintball.com. And if you type in capital TPOP, you can get 15% off of your entire order. So make sure you go over there and check out all their awesome gear. We are also brought to you by rosalife.com. They have a plethora of things for you to go over there and check out. The big thing is they can make all kinds of crazy, awesome, off the wall graphics for you, whether you're a gamer, whether you are a paintball player, a softball player, anywhere you need like custom jerseys, they can do it for you. So make sure you head over to rosalife.com, and at checkout type in capital TPOP, just like that, capital TPOP, and you can get 19% off your entire order. So make sure to head over there and check out all the goodies. So thank you to all of our sponsors. Now, for my podcast with Alex Goldman, the speedy speedster from Impact, Edmonton Impact. Those guys are having a great year again, even though they got second in Vegas, but they were plowing through people in prelims and quarters and semis and all that good stuff. But Alex has been a threat to everyone, no matter who he plays. I didn't really know his story growing up. When he played on San Diego Aftermath and his whole process of going pro, I didn't really know. He was very interesting to me, and I had a great conversation with him. And him and I talked here and there throughout the years. Really, this is the longest conversation I've ever had with him, was this podcast. But I think I got to know him a little bit more, and And I think he kind of opened up, and I have a new understanding and a new respect for him. So I'm really, really glad I got to sit down via computer camera. But I'm really glad I got to sit down and chat with him. So without further ado, thank you for tuning in, guys. Here is my podcast with Alex Goldman. We'll see ya. Alex, what's up, man?
What's going on?
Not much. Thank you for sitting down and talking to me. I appreciate it.
Yeah, I appreciate you having me on here. You got a good thing going.
Thank you. You know, I really want to take a lot of the players that are in the spotlight, not only talent-wise, but just that have been around the game for a while, and even eventually some of the young ones. But I want to kind of be able to tell your guys' story a little bit and really kind of...
Pick their brain.
I feel like this, there's a lot of paintball content out there, but I feel like it's a lot of team-oriented stuff where cameras follow the team, and you kind of get a little insight on some of the guys, but I feel like with something like this, we can really kind of dig deep and
go into depth. Yeah.
See where you came from, where, you know, what, where paintball inspired you, all that good groovy shit, you know what I mean?
Right.
So where are you at right now? Are you in, you living in San Diego?
No, I was living at my mom's in Riverside, and I actually just moved to, Dana Point. It's in, Orange County, right on the coast, next to, Laguna Beach, right by the beach. Yeah. You can literally walk there from here, and I'm living with Steven Pitts.
Yeah.
Old teammate, still friend. So yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, no, it's been a good time. So I've been living here for about 2 months now. It's expensive, but, you know, you pay for what you get. It's a nice location.
Yeah, I think that's with the California experience that I had. I think it's you definitely pay for what you get.
Yeah.
Now, you started playing paintball pretty young. What was your age when you first started playing paintball?
14. And, you know, everybody has, like, a funny story. Mine was, this kid, I was friends with a kid in eighth grade, and he invited me to his birthday party, and he was going to SC Village.
It's always a birthday party.
Right?
Someone had a birthday party.
At first, I told him, all right, yeah, let's do it. I want to go. He already had a group, whether I was going or not. And then, as, you know, the weekend was getting closer, I was getting scared because, you know, the first thing you hear is that it hurts or...
Oh, super intimidating.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So... as the Saturday was coming around, I tried to find any excuse not to go. And, you know, my dad had known about it, and he's like, look, you already told him you're going. So I'm like, all right, fine. So I'm trying to figure out, all right, what's the best way to eliminate the pan if I do end up getting shot? So I think I wore like 2 sweatshirts. I'm not even kidding. It must have been 80, 90 degrees out. And some jeans and I think sweatpants under. So... we get to SC, we had to use all the rental equipment, and I still had fun, but you know how it is with like those tipmans. You definitely know how those tipmans are, actually. And just the crappy rental mask, but you know, regardless, I did have the time of my life. I don't think I shot anybody that whole day. I don't think I got close enough to even get close to shooting them.
Yeah.
But somehow it's still some of the most fun I've ever had. And, you know, of course, I continued to play, and here I am now. But the funny thing is, the kid, his birthday, this kid named Zach, and I recently just got his number again. I was gonna call him one of these days and kind of show and tell him where I'm at.
Yeah,
because he ended up, you know, not following paintball, and it'd be interesting to tell him.
Yeah, it's kind of the same thing with my story. You know, the guy or the friend actually that I had that took me out, He no longer plays. Like, it was him and his dad who played, and he no longer plays. And I hear a lot of people's stories like that. Like, a lot of guys that have gone pro or gone far in the sport, the person that they usually started with, they like quit, fall off, go back to school, you know, whatever.
Right.
But that's cool. But then, did you play sports before paintball?
Yeah, so I played soccer. Soccer was always my sport before paintball, and I started at literally 4 years old and played all till high school, about sophomore year.
Yeah.
And at that point, I was getting too competitive with paintball, and paintball kind of took over, and I just made the decision to fully commit to paintball. But my dream at least with soccer, was to, graduate high school, finish playing varsity in soccer, and move to Europe and play
Really?
soccer over there, just because the praise for a soccer player was a lot better, and just the it was more of a lifestyle for anyone that wanted to follow that goal as be a soccer player.
Yeah, it's
I mean, the
huge over there.
MLS is getting big now in
Right.
America, but it still is not as competitive as like English Premier League or Spain and
Yeah.
whatnot. Yeah.
Yeah, you wouldn't, at least right now, you don't come off as a soccer player or a soccer lover. But I remember back then when you were what, 2003, 4, all that good stuff. You were just a little skinny guy.
Right, exactly. And that was another thing, is that was one sport that I could physically play and keep up with the other, people in the game. Of course, I wanted to try football, and maybe I should have tried baseball, but I was just too small.
Right. Yeah.
I hit puberty late, my growth spurt, and it all came later, but that was a big reason why I played soccer instead. Just I was able to keep up with the competition.
Yeah, I played soccer when I was younger, but I think I wanted to try so many different things. So I tried soccer, I tried football, I tried
Right.
baseball, I tried,
Yeah.
tried skateboarding, did all this stuff, and I think it was. Football was fun, but I was on the smaller side for football. And
Yeah.
baseball, I was right about that height, weight, age, everything where and I really
Right.
enjoyed baseball. I looking back now, I'm like, man, what would have been like? 'Cause I had a ride to Tiffin University. It's just a smaller school here, but
Yeah.
anybody can get noticed at, any school as long as you're performing. And I
Right.
always think about it, I'm like, man, because you can always go so far in paintball and make so much, or make so much of an imprint in paintball, but then you look at like baseball, football, that's all that shit, and it's like you could, the sky's the limit almost.
Right.
So it's, and that's where it's weird because in our world, in our paintball world, like people know who we are. Right, and we get that feeling of that we're appreciated and that we're noticed and that all this hard work that we missed on the week or all all the family trips and all the friend get-togethers, it's all worth something. But in the
Right.
grand scheme of things, it's like paintball is such a small little minute thing. It's
Yeah, it
ridiculous.
doesn't add up in the real life. And then if you meet someone and they ask you what your occupation is, a career, if you don't do anything aside from paintball and you tell them professional paintball, 90% of the time their response is, "Oh, I've never heard of
I didn't know you could do that professionally. Yeah.
that."
Oh my God. And then you have to explain the same story of how you
Same
can do that.
story. Same
I'm
story.
sure every
Yep.
pro has that, has
Right.
it down like exactly how they tell it every single time. And
What's funny is when we were signing our lease papers at the office for this apartment, Steven was actually saying how impressed he was with the explaining paintball, because I had to explain to them where I get my money and whatnot
yeah.
to the apartment complex. And he's like, "Man, I don't think I've heard someone explain it better." I was like, "You explain it to enough people, you'll get
Exactly.
that
You get enough
good."
practice, you get good at
Right,
it.
exactly.
Oh man. Now going back to paintball when you started getting into it, started
Right.
playing it more,
Yeah.
when and around what age did it start becoming like really serious, and what was your first like team that was actually like taking everything serious?
So I think that's where it was real fortunate for me. California, as they always said, was the Mecca for paintball, just because I think our weather and how many pro teams actually played at that one paintball park, SC Village. So you had huge opportunities. If you could find a way to have those players, the pro players, watch you play a game on the open turf field at SC Village. And so when I went to high school, it just so happened that I was friends with LJ Schwartz. He had played for Legacy, Ironman, Dynasty,
Yeah.
and he had already had a relationship with Hinman. And they both knew each other, and he knew that Hinman was starting this aftermath team. And LJ knew I wasn't good yet at paintball, but he knew I had potential, and I was out at SC Village every weekend trying to get better. So, and Hinman was looking for a kid just like that. So, one weekend I went out with LJ, and Hinman was there with the new Aftermath team. There must have been five or six guys on that team, and they had just played a local tournament. It was like Cal Jam the weekend before. And I went out there, and I was starting to play decent paintball, of course. Like, I had a lot to work on. I couldn't shoot left-handed, but for the time that I had put into paintball, I was getting pretty good quick. So LJ had mentioned to Mike before the day started about me, and I didn't even know this. And so I get ready, I'm loaded up, and I'm playing with just a throw together team against Aftermath, and we end up beating them a few games. And Hinman walks over to me. He's like, "Wow, look at Alex. He's playing good paintball today." And I look at him. Of course, I notice first thing he's wearing his Dynasty jersey. But and there's no disrespect. No, sorry. He was on Shock at the time, and I knew that was a pro team, but I didn't know Mike. He was a more under the radar type player, just because he was a back player, and no one really knew who he was unless you were on the pro scene. So I'm like, "Wow, like, how does this guy know my name? And he's noticing that I'm, playing good, decent paintball." So I was like, starstruck. And then I didn't think much of it, and I went back to my car to go load up my pods or, do whatever. And he followed me over. I'm like, "Oh man, what is he gonna say?" Because I'm 14 at this time, and I'm 5'4", 105 pounds probably. And he's an intimidating guy, whether you're a big or small person. So he comes over and he's like, "Hey, I talked to LJ, and he said you're, looking to jump on a team to play national tournaments." I was like, "Yeah, definitely." He's like, "Well, we're gonna go do some one-on-ones right now on the hyperball field if you want to go jump on." I'm like, "All right, let's do it." And I was so nervous, like, I never practiced one-on-ones, nothing, but I was like, I would do anything just to try to make the team.
Hell yeah.
So we go down there. I'm practicing against the Aftermath guys, and I win all my one-on-ones somehow. I'm scared shitless, and he noticed right away I was not putting my gun in my left hand to try to snap shoot or any of that. So he's telling me that I need to work on that, of course. And then he let me go run some games with them on the turf field again. And he was kind of testing me. He told me to go run the center 50, and he said, like, if there's a guy on the other side, go bunker him. And I'm pretty sure he told the other team to go there just to see if I was scared and wouldn't go bunker the guy. Of course, somebody calls it out. I go around, stick him. I think I went through and, bunkered another guy. Probably the best game that I had had up until that point in my career or in paintball. And right after that, I go back to my car again to go either de-gear or load up. And he has a jersey behind his back. He's like, "So do you think you could commit? There's going to be, this amount of tournaments. We practice all these weekends." I'm like, "Yeah, definitely, man. I definitely want to do that." Throws the jersey at me. It was literally the first thing I ever got for free in paintball. It was a blank Aftermath jersey with no name, but regardless, it didn't matter what it was. It just, and I still have the jersey to this day. And
That's sweet.
then that was in the off season, so 2014 going into 2015. So my first national event was LA Open 2015 with Aftermath. It was so muddy. I think you were playing with Tip and Effect. And you're in the same division with me, no?
Was it
2015.
2005?
Oh, sorry, 2005. Okay,
We
so
just started playing paintball. It's early,
yeah.
yeah. We're new.
Sorry. Wow, I totally botched this whole story.
I was waiting. I
You
was
should
like,
have.
wait.
Sorry.
So wait, so
Well,
2004,
okay, so sorry,
2004.
2004 going into 2005. Sorry. And yeah. LA Open 2005 PSP, and it rained. So I think it was the most muddiest, rainiest tournament I've played to this day,
Pomona.
if you remember correctly.
Yeah, Pomona, I
And
think, right?
yeah, exactly. And I didn't play much, and honestly, I was on the verge of getting cut just because I had done so many stupid moves during that tournament, and I was scared of Mike and how he would yell if you did anything wrong. And I sat after our first match. The rest of the tournament, but we ended up winning that event. And then, slowly but surely after that, when we would practice every weekend, I mean, he literally forced it out of me to play good paintball. He would shoot a hopper into me, anything, but like So what I wanted to explain with Hinman is
Yeah.
he's the type of coach that is either going to make you or break you. And to be honest, he's broken way more players than he's helped made in paintball. But if you could learn to buy into a system, and I think what players have always had a problem with when they're playing for him is they're so focused on the tone that he presents. And, he's an intimidating guy. You're always worried if he's going to hit you or what he says to you and how he says it. But if you can
Right.
just listen to what he's trying to explain to you, usually it's something that's you're going to learn from. He usually has good feedback and criticism.
Yeah.
So I never got distracted with how he would yell at me or anybody else, just because I felt like that athlete mentality that you needed to be able to play for Hinman.
You were learning the whole time.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I feel like it was easy for me to excel under his camp. But for others, they were just so worried and scared about what he thought or was going to do if they continued to screw up.
Yeah, I mean, he comes off as, and now, now I see him and I talk to him every once in a while, and he's like a big teddy bear. But back then, as a coach, I saw it the few times where I went down to when I went to California for excessive for practices, and even a couple times with Avalanche with practices. He's intimidating as hell, but underneath that crust of an intimidating coach is constructive criticism. And if you can, it's just like what you did. If you can see through, and it's not even see through that, it's absorb everything that he's telling you and just fucking deflect all the shit that you take as intimidating, or you take as, he's bitching at you, but taking it as a learning experience. I mean, I would have loved to have a coach like, and I did in baseball. He was my baseball coach. He was like, you either fucking play good and like how you should and how I know you can, or you're not gonna play, or he's gonna grab you by the jersey and pull you tight and say, "What the fuck are you doing? Why'd you swing at a curveball that hit the dirt 5 feet in front of you?" But and it's really it comes down, I think, kind of almost like a military thing. People quit the military or they get intimidated by shit because they can't take it. And if you can't take it, it's like you said, people are gonna drop out, and they're not gonna learn from that experience. So it's really just kind of players being able to wrap their heads around how he coaches. And obviously it works because of specimens like yourself and many others, but a lot of other many others can't really take that kind of coaching.
No, exactly. You hit it right on the button. And is it the right way? You know what? Probably not. But for the like I said, for you and I or anybody else that can handle it, man, it's no big deal. You'll be able to learn a lot under him and excel.
And I think too, why maybe those coaches were like that way, at least to us, is I think because they saw in us how much we wanted to succeed,
Exactly, they
and
wanted to
how
bring it out.
exactly they saw how much we wanted to better ourselves with each practice, with each tournament, with each game. We just wanted to be the best that we could be. And I mean, I love coaches like that. And like you said, there's not really a wrong or right. It's your way. Like if you go to coach or I go to coach, it's our way of coaching. It's your way of coaching. It's, whatever works really is
No,
what it comes down to.
exactly.
So before you got on to Aftermath, or even while you were on Aftermath, what players or teams did you really kind of look up to, or try and kind of take and reflect moves from, or style from?
So I mean, the only team was Dynasty, just because eventually Hinman went to Dynasty from Shock and he was still our coach. But we were practicing them every weekend, and I think that's the difference now. And I had a talk with Steven Pitts, is he's asking me, like, why isn't it common anymore for divisional players to come up? And divisional players, don't get discouraged out here listening to this.
Yeah.
Why isn't it common anymore that pro teams aren't picking up divisional players? And then it's not like they're not, but it's not as common as it was back in the
Right.
day, 2005, 2006. Am I right? And I think the biggest thing is now is pro teams are mainly only practicing pro teams now. You used to have those feeder teams, Aftermath. I'm sure the list goes on, but
Right.
we were the feeder team for Dynasty, not necessarily like if when we were ready we were going to be on Dynasty, but they were just, they thought we were good enough to be able to practice them and give them a decent look for that layout.
Yeah.
So I think that is the toughest thing now, is that those divisional players nowadays don't get that opportunity to practice good teams or players, and you kind of don't get to see where you're at on the radar if you do get that chance to have that pro tryout.
Yeah.
But, you know, for me, it came quick. It did. So after that first 2005 Pomona Open, I played shitty, terrible. But I knew I had to shape up quick or he was going to cut me. And I feel like I wouldn't have had anywhere to go if I wasn't on Aftermath, because no one knew who I was. And I wasn't good enough to really play for any other team. So another thing too is where we had an advantage is Hinman paid for everything.
Mm-hmm.
And now it, you definitely don't see that nowadays, is everything's fully paid for in divisional. Not even in pro now, I feel like there's pro teams that have to pay.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So that was a huge advantage we had. And so I was – and I, you know what's funny is I'll bring up the podcast with you and Oliver is – you had mentioned, you know, everything comes to an end.
Mm-hmm.
And you need to have that mentality while you're still doing whatever it is before it does come to an end, and let
oh, yeah.
that be your motivator. So that was what it was for me, is, all right, if I don't get it together, it's ending for me quicker than I expected.
Yeah.
So the next event was Orlando, and I started to play better. I wasn't, you know, necessarily one of the best on the team yet or good at that fact, but I was playing better, smarter. And then Chicago, for some reason, it just took off for me. That was the midway through the season. And again, we hadn't lost a match the whole season. And I remember after Chicago, Hinman told me, you know, that event, and I'm playing D3 X-Ball, mind you. He says, literally, you could have been on Dynasty, this
wow.
event. I'm just like, wow, you know. You know, I don't let things like that get to my head. I just let it motivate me and keep pushing harder, just because I do want to be one of the best at whatever it is I'm doing. I'm so highly competitive, and I think people will get that misunderstood about me, that I'm an asshole or I talk shit. No, that's just my competitive edge. And if you didn't play sports in the past or you don't watch sports, then you'll never understand.
Right.
Because I'd do anything to win a game. And so after that, you know, of course, we end up losing our first match against, I think you were still on the team, no tip in effect, in Northeast Open. You guys beat us twice that event, once in the prelims and then in the semi or the finals, we got second. And then World Cup, we came for redemption and beat you guys.
Was it Tip and Effect or was it Avalanche?
No, it was the name was Tip and Effect. I'm sure later on it was all those players on Avalanche.
What year was it?
2005.
Well, 2005 was my very first year, full year pro. And then
You were on Excessive.
I was on 2004 so World Cup.
Four,
I
you
was
on Tip and Effect.
Yeah, 2004
okay.
I was on Tip and Effect.
Okay. All right. That makes sense.
Yeah, 2004 World Cup is when was my first tournament with Excessive. And then, see, I remember playing you guys. See, when did you leave Aftermath?
So, yeah, it's kind of confusing. So, 2006, I remained on Aftermath. But midway through, I ended up being good friends with Brandon Short. And he was on the Ironman. And he was always in my ear trying to get me on Ironman. He said, like, I'm ready. Let's do this. So, you know, and then Shane Pistano was in my ear as well. So, you know, they manipulated me. And I ended up joining on Ironman for one tournament, Chicago 2006. And we ended up getting second place. But then I think. That's right.
That's right.
And
yeah.
You were on Excessive. We beat you in the prelims.
That was a good
and
game,
you
though.
Guys
yeah.
had a huge comeback and ended up beating us. And I was pretty pissed because that'd have been cool to win my first pro tournament.
I had to win because that was my parents' first tournament they came and watched. So we had to win.
All right. Well, yeah, we let you have it. Anyways. After the event, I sat Dave down right away. I'm like, man, you know, I feel terrible about this leaving Aftermath. You know, at least let me finish the season with them. You know, it sounds crazy, but at least let me finish the season with them, and then I'll give you my word to rejoin the team going into the next season, 2007.
Yeah.
He's like, you know what? Fair enough. Yep, go ahead, do your thing. So I end up going back to Aftermath for the rest of the season. And actually, a crazy story is I'm going to bring this up and put everybody on blast that was on that team. Was so the way Aftermath did it with all the winnings, and we won a lot that year, was they would save it in a bank, and they were going to divvy it out to everybody at the end of the season,
Yeah.
and everybody's going to have a good check. And everybody had on the team in the off season at least eventually heard that I was going to go to the Ironman, so they all had a team meeting without me and said, well, if this guy's already going to quit, why is he getting paid? But I felt like, and in Chicago, they got third place Aftermath. So I felt like all those tournaments we won that year, I was in
You
there.
were a part
Like
of.
I deserved it just as much as anybody else.
Yeah.
And somehow I got voted out of a check. And
Really?
of course, if I didn't have my decision made yet, that definitely solidified it. And I remember literally driving away in tears, like, I can't believe, like, I called those guys my friends and they
Yeah.
didn't decide to let me have my fair share. But I remember I made the call to Ironman. I'm like, let's do this. And Aftermath ended up being semi-pro after that, so I didn't even get a chance to really put it on them for any of that. But
Yeah. That's
yeah,
crazy. That's crazy because
you know. And I held that
wow.
against them for so long, man. And
I can
believe it or
understand
not,
why.
one of those guys is rainy. One of those guys is rainy.
Still gotta give him shit.
No, and I do. But just like anything else, you gotta let it go.
Yeah.
And everything happens for a reason, I believe. And I think most of those guys aren't even playing paintball anymore, so
Right. That's crazy. That is so
it's a
crazy
sad
to me.
story.
Yeah,
Yeah.
it's more of a
And
dick
actually,
story.
to top it all off, was Rainey and Ronnie end up joining Ironman as well from Aftermath. After they decided that I don't deserve my money because I'm leaving anyways,
Yeah.
they end up taking their share and then they quit.
Jeez.
It's something I don't even like to talk about because it makes
Right.
me rethink the whole situation, but I feel like it needed to be heard.
Yeah, for
So,
sure. I mean,
yeah.
that's fucking
So
nuts.
I had that as my fire going into 2007, and I thought that was a huge year for me because that was my first official year pro. And again, they had the first, it was PSP in LA for their first tournament in 2007. And I thought I had such a ridiculously good tournament. I would go to the X every point. It was just one of those fields you couldn't stop a guy going up the center.
Yeah.
And I'd find a hole and just run through every odd point, killing people. But I that was a really good season, and I learned a lot, but from so many guys that year. Just that was when rosters were 15 and player, 15 guys on the team.
Yeah.
And our team had literally legends on the team: Billy Cyransky, Todd Adamson, Ryan Williams, Miko, Mike Paxson still playing, Mr.
Oliver.
Yu, Oliver
Yeah.
in his prime.
Was Cuba playing for you guys at the time?
Yep, Nicky Cuba. I mean, that list right there, and then in Shane Pastana coaching.
On top of that,
Come on, man.
yeah.
I was putting things together so quick and elevating my game every tournament practice.
Yeah,
It
if you're
just
not learning on a squad like that, you're doing something wrong.
right. So that I really think paved the way for the rest of my career, and of course, I'm planning on keeping it going for as long as I can. So
Yeah.
after 2007, I went back to Aftermath because I had some fallouts with a player or two on the Ironman. I just didn't feel comfortable on the team anymore, and
Yeah.
it's actually kind of tragic because who would have known what could have come of it if I would to stay on the Ironman. And I feel like I wasn't the reason players started to leave, but maybe I could have helped keep players on that team, because like as soon as I quit and went back to Aftermath, that's when Sean McDonald quit paintball and started working on the boat.
Crunchy,
But I
right?
think Yeah, exactly. They
Yeah.
call him Crunch. I still talk to him every day. But I just guys like that maybe would have stayed in the game and we could have stayed together, but so I go back to Aftermath. We got our butts whooped all year, but 2008, I think we ended up winning one event, a 7-man event in Jacksonville. Actually, we beat the Ironman in the finals. That was huge because that was when like Fox Sports filmed that tournament, so that was pretty
Yeah.
cool.
Yeah, I remember
Right. And then 2009, still on Aftermath. We're still struggling to like make it to that next level. And 2010, Aftermath again. And then Dynasty, 2011 and 12. What's so weird is 2011 Dynasty, man, we had a hell of a year. I think we won like our first three events with the PSP, the Millennium, and then the MPPL. And then we played consistent throughout the year. I don't think we won another event, but we were placing seconds, thirds. And then the next year, 2012, I don't think we changed much as far as the roster, the dynamic, but we had such a terrible season. It just didn't add up. And then guys were having conflict with Hinman coaching, and then Hinman ends up leaving. And things just started falling apart left and right. I guess I made like a, it was pretty cowardly for me to leave right before World Cup, but like I was just over it at that point, and I felt like it was a cancer staying on the team. Like I felt like none of the guys wanted to change anything that was going on wrong in the camp. I wanted to go out on the off weekends and fix whatever it was that wasn't working for us, or just talk to each other during the week, just whatever it was. I just feel like there was a lack of effort there. So I joined Damage going into that 2012 World Cup. We ended up getting second, but I just had to get out of that camp with Dynasty. And then after I played that one tournament with Damage, I went to Ironman. I know it all sounds crazy going from team to team, but you got to think too is, and I'm not trying to get ahead of myself here, but I feel like I've always had an offer on the table with one of the top teams in paintball, and we don't have agents to represent us or whatnot, so it's tough to deal with this on your own, and you have to sit there and figure out, okay. This team A, B, and C are offering this, this, and this. And then do you want to play for this team because of the offer, or do you want to play for this team because they're local, or this team because of the roster? It's so many factors. And it's for me, and I'm still growing at this point, trying to figure out who I am and what I can offer. But,
Well, it's
what's
how it
that?
is. I mean, it's how it
Right.
is with paintball. It's like
Exactly. You
it'd
know, I'd rather literally pay someone to deal with that for me and just let me focus on my game.
Yeah, I'd love to be in that position, but it's just it's not, you know, with you know, I wish I could play more paintball too. I feel like I could be so much more of a rounded player if I was able to, even before my son was born. But if I had a field that was close where I had players, you know, nothing against the divisional players here, but it's nothing like what you would have or what like the Texas teams have or anything like that. And it's I feel like that's the one big disadvantage that the Midwest players have had is just one, the winter, but then two, we just haven't really had we don't really have that many teams to play as far as pro teams or higher divisional teams. That's the tough part.
You know what, too, though, that's a good point you bring up. As you get older, playing any sport, it's not that the game gets tougher because you're getting older or aging. It's that responsibilities start to come on. Like you said, you have your kid. Dalton just had his kids, so it's you have to start putting your focuses little by little on different responsibilities, and that's when your main focus that at the time with paintball starts to fade. And hopefully that doesn't happen to you or I anytime soon.
I'm
But
hoping not.
so going back to it, 2013, I'm on Ironman. and Hinman decides to coach that team. And I'm again on this a team that just can't break through to that, like that top four tier. And we had flashes of good play throughout the season, but just couldn't put it together. And then 2014, I stayed on the Ironman, but they ended up cutting Hinman as a coach in the off season, and then they brought on Shane as the coach again. And again, the same story. Good team, or you know, decent team, young guys, hungry, and we just couldn't put it together. And yeah. I had some conflict with young blood with my contract, and I didn't like how I was being treated, and how he was trying to just lock me in and hold me in,
right,
without me being able to have a respectful decision. So I just got out of there and played with Infamous in 2015.
Yeah.
And actually, that was one of my funnest years in paintball. I definitely enjoyed playing with Damien and Brad and
really?
Callie and Trevor and all those guys, and having Travis as a coach. And but as far as, you know, funding, it was just one of those things where I wanted to fully commit to paintball and have it as my career and just fully focus on that. And so after 2015, I made the move to Impact. Of course, well-funded team.
Yeah.
And rightfully so. I mean, man, the way just the whole process Impact does and takes in the game is just it's how a team should be treated, just as far as the professional aspect and just the approach Bart has. It's unreal.
Oh yeah,
you know,
yeah.
It's one of those things. It's like, God, you know, why wasn't it like this my whole career? And it's unfortunate that most players that have reached that level won't be able to witness that luxury.
Yeah.
But
yeah, it's tough though.
Yeah.
But I can see that, like what you guys are going through. I can see that from a third person perspective, because just the way everything is structured, the way you guys communicate and play off of each other is you can tell that there's something, there's another key in there.
It's just that next level.
Yeah, it's huge.
And I don't know if you're paying attention to social media, but for some reason I feel like there's just a lot of people against what we have going on. I don't know if it's because of the winning, or I think a lot of it is the funding. And I think guys are sour about how they're on a competitive team as well, but they're not getting paid. But I mean, why bad talk us though? It's especially the players. We're not in a position to negotiate that for you or change any of that. That's nothing in our hands. If anything, be happy for us that players in the game have made it to that
can
level,
reach that level
where
yeah.
I can pay for my own place and my own food and you know, enjoy my life and still just play paintball and not have to work a 9-to-5. But other players think otherwise, and I disagree with that. But also too is, yeah, I had a good talk with Hinman. Is he looked at it in a different way, is those bottom teams, like you know, who do we got now, PC Katana, those guys that don't have funding like that, not even close, he thinks they're just gonna eventually get discouraged and jump ship, just because why even try when you have a team like us or Heat that has that funding? But for me, I don't know, maybe it's easier for me to say because I'm on the other side of the fence, but I would let that be a motivation, like, all right, these guys are getting paid for the same thing I do. Fuck that. I'm going to go rip these guys up, and I'm going to steal that winning check.
Yeah, but you took the words, dude, honestly, you took the words right out of my mouth. At least that's what
that
I do. I respect
that
it. I respect the hell
FMS.
Out of you guys.
Yeah.
One, because you are living the dream that when we first turned pro, we wanted to be the best we could be. We wanted to play the best teams. We wanted to do all that shit. Secondly, we wanted to get paid for it, which was, you know, which was another goal we wanted to do. You guys are living that. So I have mad, mad respect for you guys. But it wasn't fucking easy because you guys worked your ass off to get to where you were. Like you said, everything happens for a reason. So someone in my position where, I mean, I've been playing, you know, just as long as you have and a little bit longer, but but everything happens for a reason. And how you guys, or how your whole program goes about things is awesome to me. And it motivates me because it makes me feel like there's a chance for paintball to get to that level where every team has a budget, where every team has a paycheck to where they can, you know, make these players play more paintball because they're paying them a 9-to-5 wage. And to me, it's motivation because I know we don't have the funding like, excuse me, like a lot of the other teams do.
Right.
But, and that's what I'm, I don't even think I have to say it to the new guys on Aftershock because they're just flat out fucking hungry. And that's what we need is regardless.
And that's how it should be.
Exactly. Who has to pay for what or what or the, I mean, it's a lot easier if you don't have a bunch of chaos going on and you don't have to worry about a bunch of different things. But if you can do that and harness that hunger and that drive towards beating these teams and then off the field, respecting them and being completely fine with them, then that, I mean, that's how I feel it needs to be. To me, anyway, that's how it is.
Right.
I respect you guys for that. I respect Bart for that.
Exactly. I totally agree. But I just feel like some other players think otherwise, and I'm not going to name drop or anything. But
yeah. Fuck, I wish I got paid to play as much as some other guys, but that's not gonna steer me from my path.
And it shouldn't.
And no, yeah. I just bought a heavy bag that I'm starting to hit. I just, you know, I'm just getting ready
Dalton's
to.
Dalton's got one of those too.
Yeah, you know, I'm 31 years old, but it doesn't mean that I would rather. So and it, I think it kind of ties into you too. It's like I've never been one to go out and hit the weights. A lot of my talent, at least, you know, non-paintball, but just like running, jumping, fucking doing all kinds of weird, crazy flips or whatever, that's all been natural shit, right? I've just been able to do that, like speed-wise. I've just been able to run fast, and that really didn't hit until after high school. I've just been able to do that because I was never one to go to the gym and be a gym rat and do all this stuff. It just wasn't who I was.
Yeah, and that's pretty impressive. You do some crazy stuff out there.
And I'm not saying it as like well, I can fucking do this because it's just, you know, I don't have to work out. Dude, my body is sore as shit whenever I'm done playing games or anything like that. But I do watch what I eat. I don't eat like shit. I'm starting to actually hone in on tighter things in my diet and start cutting out a lot of the bad carbs and the shitty carbs and everything else. But I'm actually starting to bring in a physicality to my off game and get to your level or get to better than where I'm at now. And, you know, better late than never, I feel.
No, of course. It's never too late. And, man, your body is your temple. And
mm-hmm.
It's going to react to what you put in your body or how you treat it. Why not give it the best and treat it like a, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, if you want to talk about diet.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
This morning, I had 8 egg whites, 1 cup of oatmeal, a mix of berries.
Did you say 8 egg whites?
Yeah. It would be different for anybody's goal.
Yeah.
For me, I'm always trying to maintain a lot of muscle and just a bigger physique than others.
Right.
So I'm not telling everyone out there listening to go eat 8 egg whites. I'm sure you could be fine eating half of that, but
do you think that limits you as far as like how big you are? Like, do you think that limits you as far as playing
what?
At all? Like playing, like playing and maneuvering your body.
It makes it easy, yeah. You know, I think I just got caught up in living like a, I don't want to say like a bodybuilder, but a, more of a just a healthy lifestyle, and
it's addictive.
It is, and I went from just working out to stay in shape to I got stronger, and I'm going to push it and see how much more weight I can do, and it just progressed, and here I am now.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, it doesn't slow you down, I'll tell you that.
Right, and that's what I make sure is that I still feel and look athletic out there.
Right.
And the day I don't, and I'll be like, hey, let's change it up here.
Right.
But I think I still keep up with the best of them.
Yeah, you're one of the best of them, asshole.
I appreciate
Yeah.
that, man.
So
So
what was the
back.
turning point? What actually, before we get into like the diet and everything, what was the
Right.
turning point of where you were kind of like,
For fitness.
yeah, I need to do something, or
So, dude, just like my mentality for paintball, like it didn't matter what life threw in my way, I was gonna go pro and I wanted to be one of the best. So in weightlifting and dieting didn't come till a few years later, but being in the gym, I didn't care what was gonna stop or try to stop me. I was gonna lift hard, get big. It didn't matter.
Right.
You have to have that mentality. Yeah, you're gonna go through times that you definitely wasted because you could have took a smarter approach, but that's all trial and error. And you go through that with anything. So for me, I started lifting weights at 18, 19. Again, I told you I grew late, and you witnessed that yourself.
Yeah.
And so I didn't start lifting till my body I felt like was, I hit my last growth spurt and whatnot. So yeah, 18, 19, I started lifting. And I feel like back then I was trying to go harder in the gym than I do now. The only difference is, so around 21, 22, I started reading books and just manuals online about dieting, and that changed the game for me. Literally, what you put in your body or how much or the timing of it can change everything. And not only was I able to pack on size correctly and add muscle, but my energy levels and my mental focus, it just all came together. And when I tell people that I eat clean or I'm on a diet, I think they have their own perspective, but and I try to show it on Instagram,
Yeah.
but I think I really take it to a whole nother level as far as the whole eating clean. And there's guys in paintball that know what I'm talking about, Phil Shredder and I'm sure a few others, but I don't think someone really knows what it takes when I say eating clean or healthy or high protein or carb diet until they witness it or do it for themselves. I'm not kidding you. Throughout the day, I'm eating or snacking every hour or every other hour, and it's
Yeah.
not just
I think
I and
that's a
it's
big misconception is
right.
people think that, oh, well, you
It
only eat
is
certain time.
literally a job in itself.
Yeah. Yeah.
Steven Pitts, he's my roommate now. He literally couldn't believe it the first week we're living together, how much I eat. And he's asking me how much does it cost. And I think it adds up the same way if you're going out and eating,
It's
or
exactly.
exactly, or you're actually saving money because you buy it in bulk. But it didn't matter to me for price. It just I wanted to eat healthy and I like how I felt. So I mean, we could sit here all day and tell you what to eat and why.
Yeah.
But the list goes on, and I'll just go over the surface level of it. So breakfast, I told you, oatmeal and egg whites. Then I'll usually go work out around 10 or 11, and then right afterwards I'll have my protein shake, banana and apple, and then I'll come home. No less than an hour after that, I'll have my, I guess, lunch. And so another thing is you want to switch up your sources of nutrition. So for protein, you don't always want to just eat chicken because your body's going to get used to that and you won't benefit off it the same way you were in the beginning.
Right.
So I like to switch that up with chicken, beef, or I like fish, grilled salmon or some mahi,
Yeah.
and then a cup of rice. And then again, same idea for vegetables as you do with the protein. I like to switch that up: spinach, broccoli, asparagus. And then, a few hours later, have a meal with all those choices, the same type of thing. Then dinner, I like to have some red meat, steak, baked potato, a salad. And then before I go to bed, I'm not even kidding you, six egg whites.
Really?
Two slices of what's called Ezekiel bread. It's like a organic wheat bread,
Yeah.
natural peanut butter, and then there's a different purposed protein shake called casein protein that feeds your body time released. So it's like 8 hours, so within the time span of you sleeping.
Wow.
And that's on a daily basis. And mind you, I'm watching how much water I take in as well, so around 1 gallon a day.
So is it around 1 gallon each day that you're taking in?
Of water, yeah.
I've heard that too. That's key is
Right.
staying hydrated throughout a day of even when you're not working out even as much as you are or the
Exactly.
diet that you have, but just hydration.
You'd be surprised how better the body operates while the body stays hydrated throughout the day. I'm not talking in a short span, but throughout the day. And you know what bugs me so much is all that's out the door when I'm in paintball. When we're on a trip, practice, tournaments, it's all out the door.
That's your cheat
You
week.
just, I've been playing how long? 10, 12 years.
Jeez.
I've tried to figure it out. You just can't. If your hotel doesn't have a kitchen or fridge or microwave, it doesn't matter what you do. You just can't
It's
sometimes.
so hard.
So that mentality just kind of goes out the door, which is unfortunate because that's when I need it most. That's when I really need it most. Yeah, it's nice to feel energized and strong while I'm in the gym, but forget that. I do all this for paintball, and if I could eat the same way and get that sleep and just the way I take care of my body throughout a tournament or practice, God forbid. But sometimes you can't.
So as far as the gym goes, how long or what not necessarily your routine, but like because I'm sure you have back legs throughout the week, but like how long of a time span do you usually spend at the gym each day?
To be honest, I don't like to stay in there longer than an hour and a half tops. I don't agree with that whole 2 hours, 2.5 hours. That makes
That's a long
no
time.
sense. That means you're taking too many rest or you're overtraining. For me, I like to keep it kind of high intensity, minimize the rest periods, and just hit it hard while I'm in there. But yeah, like you said, I do the whole split workout with the Monday's chest, Tuesday back, whatever.
Now, obviously you've probably heard this over and over again. I've heard it over and over again, where paintball is, 90% mental, 10% physical. So you being so physical and so athletic, when do you think your mental game kind of started kicking in, and kind of how do you look at the game and how do you look at moves and timing?
Yeah, that's the funny thing you bring up. I think it came opposite for me as compared to a lot of players, at least, is physical came first for me, and I was able to make those big open moves and just those quick bumps. And then honestly, the whole mental thing is I'm still learning that. I am. When I didn't think there was anything else for me to learn in this game, join Impact. I'm not kidding you. You still learn. Just little things. If I were to coach a team now, the biggest thing I would praise is communication. I look back at the tapes this past year of our games. I can't tell you how many times, especially a team like you guys, and I'm not trying to talk down or anything, but you guys would be in the being all the 50s before us. The reason we dug you guys out is why the talking. We knew where you were looking, just who was on who, just the small chit chat will open up a game. And eventually you'll talk it out where there's a hole, and then that move's created. I think in the beginning for my careers, I was always go, go, go. And yeah, that'll work a lot, sometimes, if not a lot of times, if you do it correctly, but that's not going to win you a tournament. The whole communication, if you're talking across the board, that move's going to be there. It doesn't matter in the beginning or end of that point. It's going to be there. You'll figure it out. And then you're not so rushed. And I'm still learning that pace on this team. I really am. I feel like last year I didn't really reach my potentials where I could be on this team as far as the talent we have. And that's another thing is it's tough. You have 10 guys on this team that were picked up for a specific reason. This whole roster was handpicked. And it is so highly competitive, man. If you get shot off the break once or you get dinked out of your bunker twice, that's it for you. And you can't take offense to that. And I did just because I had an immature mind. But you have to look at it at a professional standpoint was you have other guys on this roster. You can't blame them for sitting you if you're not doing it,
If you're not doing the
And that's
job, then someone else is right there behind you ready to step in.
Exactly. And that was a tough pill for me to swallow, and I think that's helped me though as a person and as a teammate in paintball, being on Impact and understanding that it's not all about me or,
yeah,
you know, there are 9 other guys on this roster and they can do that same thing you can if you're not getting the job done.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Yeah, I can see that. And I think a lot of people tend to look past that. And then right. It's like we said earlier, they look past that and they look at, and see, they're getting paid and, you know, they're just this big, money boat that just goes by and they just do whatever they want. Well, I mean, there's a reason you guys are successful, one, and two, dude, if it's just like any other sport, man, take the fucking Dallas Cowboys, for example. I don't really follow football that much, but look at Tony Romo, gets hurt. Dude comes in, plays well, dunzo.
Right.
I mean, that's it, and that's all it takes. And it's just like even like I watch a lot of hockey, a lot of NHL, and it's just like any other sport, especially on a team like Impact, is that
right.
If you are not doing the job that you're here to do, you better damn well know that the guy next to you or the guy behind you or in line behind you is ready and willing to do it more than you are doing now. You know, and
right.
I mean, that's kind of how I see it. Is the guy who's waiting to perform is wants it more than you,
right.
And you know, and it's just the way it is. It's just how when I was playing and I wasn't starting in sports, right? I was next to the coach, standing there, and just always fucking ready, always you know showing him that anytime that he needed me, I was ready. And when I got my chance, you know, I never looked back. And
right.
It's the same way on your guys' team, and I think people need to know that it's a cutthroat thing. I mean, it's family, don't get me wrong. I mean, paintball teams are a whole different family, but if you're not fucking working out, man, it's not gonna work out.
Right. No, exactly. I totally agree. And it starts from the practices, and I've definitely noticed that is Dave and Bart, they get their, you know, get-togethers and they start to talk it over,
mm-hmm.
you know, who should be starting in these spots or who do you think will get the majority of the PT going into the tournament at least. Obviously, that can all change once that tournament starts.
Right.
But you want to go into it confident and just going on a roll.
Mm-hmm.
So there's just no time wasted on this team as soon as
yeah.
you gear up. But I like that. I really do.
Yeah. And that's how it was for me on after X Factor was,
yeah.
you know, everything came down to practice, which it should. I mean, don't get me wrong. You know, I'm not saying that I don't practice. I don't want to practice. Fuck, I want to practice all the time.
Right.
You know, I want to play all the time. But for some reason, practices, I just, every single ball finds me some way, somehow.
Yeah, it's tough.
And timing is tough. But when the tournaments come around, just something clicks. And I'm able to make those moves, and I'm able to make those shots like that I was missing in practice. I'm making those 1-2 balls and then going. And I think that's what a big key when I was on X Factor and why it didn't work out was because practices, I struggled. And
yeah.
and if that's what they're seeing and they're flying me out to these practices and I'm playing like dog shit, then yeah, they're not going to play me, and then I'm not going to be able to get that chance in the tournament.
Yeah, no, that's a tough one.
Yeah.
But, you know, in all fairness for the coach, that has to be their indicator.
Exactly.
You know, yeah, that's a tough one.
Yeah, yeah. But luckily with Aftershock, you know, they know that I experiment at practice. And,
right. No,
you know,
as you should.
Yeah, yeah. So, go ahead.
No.
I was just going to say it ended up working out for the most part at the tournaments.
Right. I was going to say is I think for most of my career, I think the biggest mistake I always made was so focused on trying to win at practice, which means nothing,
mm-hmm.
nothing. Get through the practice without any injuries is my biggest concern.
Yeah, exactly.
And then obviously learn the layout. Those are the two things. I don't care if we lose every fucking point.
Mm-hmm.
Get through it and learn. Those are my two biggest things now.
Yeah,
and I was so focused just because I was highly competitive, and I still am. I'm just maturing and understanding the bigger picture.
Mm-hmm.
The thing is you're not going to win anything at practice. I can't tell you how
Yeah.
many times I killed it out of practice. I'm not sh like I would just shit on a team, and then come to a tournament and not nearly play that level, and it would hurt the team because they're expecting this level of play out of me. So, for a guy like you, where you say you would struggle, that sometimes that almost helps because when you step up at a tournament, that you're taking so much stress off the team when they didn't expect anything, and then now you're showing up when it fucking matters. I mean, I would like that instead, but.
I wouldn't want to be reversed, that's for sure.
Right.
But I've always struggled with consistency. And
Well, and I think we play similar positions. I think we have the hardest spot as far as being consistent.
right.
And I'm not trying to take away from the twos and threes. Those are, just as important, if not more important, roles. But for us to run a spot or get into a certain spot where the team knows that we're going to, and they
Which is most
start
of the
to
time,
know
yeah.
most time, if not every time nowadays. Come on, they know us. Every pro team knows us. They know how
Exactly.
we play, and they study your tendencies throughout the event. Of course, it's going to be tough to play consistent, but I've always been a guy to say no excuses. And another thing is the reffing too, is people like to blame it on calls and favoritism. Play above it. Just play above it.
You have
You
to.
know, you have to.
And it's like you're saying, like we play similar positions, and I think what makes it tough in our positions is that we're in a constant fight because we're normally the closest to the other team,
Right.
and we are still having to communicate but be aggressive and shoot guys at the same time. So I think it's such a weird position to play that people take for granted. You know, we're not just these fast, fast athletes off the break we get here, but we have to get to our spot one, and two, we gotta do damage after that.
Right.
And it's
Yeah.
so tough.
And I think we, in that aspect, it is an important role because based on how we play, I feel like how it goes for the rest of your team. You obviously, you make it so much easier if you get to the spot you're supposed to and shoot two, three, four guys. I mean, that's it right there. The rest of your team should be able to finish the game. But if you're getting shot early, of course, now that next guy has to step it up, and it's just a lot more pressure. So we do dictate how the game's played.
Yeah, I think we do set the pace. That's
Yeah.
for sure. On and off the field, I feel like when we come off confident,
That's true. Yeah.
I think it affects the team immensely. And kind of talking about mentality and then how we play our game. Are you more of like a control? Do you like feeling like, obviously everybody likes feeling in control, but I mean, even when you got two, three guns on you, do you always feel like you're in control of the situation?
You know, no. And but you kind of have to lie to yourself or tell yourself that you will figure that situation out. You have to basically kid yourself to play with confidence, because if you start to doubt it, you're going to make a stupid move or just second guess things where that move should have been made. And that's where I still nowadays run into that trouble is my timing's off sometimes because you do lack that confidence if you're getting shot early or they do have that extra gun on you. But and that is where that mental game is played, is how do you react from that? And playing the game, as long as you and I have it shouldn't be a problem anymore. But I feel like we
Dude,
still
this
run
game is a
into this.
constant problem.
It is,
Problem
yeah.
solving.
Right. And I think a lot of it is no tournament's ever the same. The layouts, just there's just so many factors that you can never predict how a tournament's going to go or how your play is going to be. But yeah, as far as mentally, you have to go in there positive, regardless of how you've been playing in the past or that previous point. You just, again, have to kid yourself and just move on. And just like simply keep it positive.
And I think the players in our position too, I think we're trying to solve a constant puzzle. Like, it's hard to explain because when you're playing paintball and you're playing a position like we are, where normally more than one guy is shooting at us, because I think that's a tough position too, is the twos and threes important as shit, don't get me wrong. But normally
Right.
they're shooting at one or two guys. They normally have control back there. We're usually having to gain control after the fact.
Yeah,
And
no, you're right.
we have so many things going through our mind of, can I move now? Wait, I gotta talk to this guy. How many G's? Where are they at? Two or three in your head. You're almost listening to the. I'm telling you, this is kind of like what's going through my head. Like,
Right.
you're almost listening to the pace, even though the guns are ramping. You're almost listening to the pace of the way the guy is shooting at you.
No, of course, every back player has a beat on their lane.
Yeah,
sure.
You know what I'm talking about.
That da da da, or the constant stream. It's
mm-hmm.
one of those, and you can time it to come out. Of course.
Yeah, and I think the biggest weapon that we have that I think I'm seeing for some reason slowly slip away. The older players still have it, but it's the head check, dude. Yeah, I don't
yeah.
know how many times I've been able to head check a guy. Have him turn his gun for a second, and I go out the other side and make
Right.
a spot. I think it's I don't see enough young players doing that.
Yeah, I think that just comes with experience, though, and
Yeah.
being comfortable with the game and understanding that you can get away with a move like that. And thank you for reminding me. I should use that more often because I feel like I'm able to just as much as anyone else to be able to pull a move off like that, but.
Oh, hell yeah.
Again, but sometimes that move just isn't there. And then that's where I fall back on where I say communicate. If you can't move, might as well get something going with the rest of your team.
Exactly. The pace, man, and that's where we come back to the pace of the game.
Exactly. And I always say two things. Be involved. If you're sitting in your bunker and you can't make that move, then start a conversation with somebody on your team, your two or across field, and don't die with information is what we always say on Impact. Meaning is, if you make a move, say into the snake, and you see the W, call that out before you go crawling down and shoot him in the back or whatever the case was. But don't die with information. Because
Right.
now you died with something that you knew what was
Value.
Hot, but maybe exactly.
Yeah.
And I just think it's something so basic that gets dropped even in on the pro level.
Yeah. Yeah, 100%. And I think people tend to overdo it with, believe, don't get me wrong, individual skill is huge. I mean, you
Right.
want your shot on, you want to be able to snap shoot and run and shoot like yourself or you know, but if you're not a team player and you can't be on the field a part of that five and play like you're one, then you can be the best fucking snapshot in the world, but if you can't play as a team and you can't do that, it's not gonna happen.
No, exactly. I totally agree. Fundamentals are important, but like you're saying, you have to put it together as a package, and it just has to work. Basically, like instruments, it's got to be fluid and. Exactly. If you can have the best snapshot, but if you don't put it together with the team, it is you can win points, but you won't win a game like that.
Exactly. Exactly. Far from a fucking tournament, that's for sure. and I think that's why Impact and yourself have been so successful is because everyone has their attributes and their keys on this team. And everyone fits in those locks and those key positions, and you guys perform the hell out of them. But you
Right.
guys play as a fucking team, and you play all
Exactly.
the time together as a team. And I explain people this on other podcasts and conversations, and they ask me, well, why do you think Impact's so successful? This and that. And I was like, one, I mean, it just is what it is. It's there is money involved, and that gives you the opportunity to play more as a team, to feel comfortable as a team, and to adjust as a team. So money is at the top level, but you can buy all the players in the world that you want, but if they're not believing in the system and they're not trying to better themselves and be a part and just be one of 10 or one of 8 or whatever you're running with instead of one of one, then it's not going to work.
Yeah, then it's a wash. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, so I mean there's plenty that goes into it, but it's your guys's oneness, if you will, on the field that kills it, and it works. And you guys had a great tournament against Dynasty, but in that tournament, or in that game anyway, they played and had the moves that they did, and came out on top. That's, if anything, that shouldn't discourage anybody. It wouldn't me, and we've been playing this game long enough to know that that's fucking tackling fuel for the next tournament. So, and I think another part of being pro and playing as long as we have is taking those tournaments and using that for, fuel and that push for the practices in between the next event and performing better at the next event.
You had brought something up earlier in this conversation with the whole money thing, and impact is something I wanted to make clear for anybody listening is for as far as the practice aspect, we do not practice any more or less than any other team. I'll tell you, our schedule going into Dallas is probably less paintball than the other pro teams. So we get together as a team for a team practice on the second weekend of the layout, not the first. Some of us go out, the local guys from California will go to Dave's field the first weekend just to get a look at the field and play DMG. But the second weekend is actually our first real team practice. And so going into Dallas, we're going to fly to Florida and practice damage. And then straight from there, we're going to fly to Dallas, rest there for a few days, and then practice heat right before the event. It literally 3 days on the layout for us as a team. So for anyone to say we had the luxury to practice as much as, yeah, we probably do, but we don't. We just don't, you know? And I just, that's one less excuse for someone that's hating on us. So.
And if I didn't want it to seem like I was doing that,
No, and I know you weren't. I'm just
if
making it clear
anything,
for.
yeah. It's able to play against other pro teams, I guess, is more the direction of,
Okay.
so you get the
That's
opportunity
true.
to play against those top tier other pro teams, whether they be in fucking Alaska or Texas or California or
That's true.
whatever. But so fucking what? I mean, there's gonna be always gonna be somebody better. There's always gonna be somebody worse. There's always gonna be. So,
You
you
know
have
what?
to live this
After
moment.
doing this podcast with you, I hope I can talk to Bart and get a practice set up with you guys.
Dude, first, I'm
So,
totally down,
you
man.
know.
I'm always down.
Just to, help each other out. So,
And as we're getting towards the end of the conversation too,
yeah.
I wanted to tell you this, that you've been one of my biggest pushes. Like you've been,
Really?
like honestly, man, you are one of the top players on my list, no matter what position you play, whether D side, snake side, of someone who I watch and I try to not necessarily be like, but keep up with. And I respect the hell out of you. I think you're a damn good fucking paintball player. And I wish you the best of luck, and I think that you're such a big inspiration for not only paintball players, but for on the field, but off the field. And your professionalism, I think, is, I don't know you that well, but the times that we get to sit and talk, this is the longest we've ever talked, but the time that I have talked to you, your professionalism has, gone through the roof. And I just wanted to tell you that there's no, even though we've ran against each other and there's the fastest man in paintball, there's this, there's that, you're fast as fuck. And I like competition, but I don't like confrontation. So I never wanted there to feel like there was any kind of anything between that, and I don't think there was. But dude, as someone like yourself, there was always intimidation, even for me. But I wasn't gonna let it show.
No.
But yeah, I mean,
Hey.
I just respect the hell out of you. I just wanted to tell you that.
I appreciate that a lot, man. And it's always a blessing to hear that because, like you said, this is the longest conversation we've had, so you never really know what's on someone's mind, even though you always see them day in, day out throughout the tournaments. And it, no, it's definitely refreshing to hear that because and I don't want to say it just sound like it's out of spite, but I definitely have always looked up to your game just because we play similar roles, and I feel like you've always taken that artsy, more creative approach, running a bunker or getting to a spot, and I like that. And even if we ever had some turmoil between us, I never take anything personal. Put it this way. We practiced X Factor, I think, almost every before every tournament from last year, going and even going into Vegas. And the one guy, if he listens, he'll laugh, that always speaks up on their team or talks a little shit is Michael. And of course, it's F you, F that. And him and I will go at it. And some it could even be pushing back and forth sometimes, but what I respect about him, and I'm the same way in that aspect, is once we're off the field, we're cool. It's all left on the field, and that's how it should be, and that's how an athlete should take it in that approach. But so if you take it personal, it's gonna mess with you mentally, and it might distract your game. But
Because
no,
there, I mean, there's definitely a few players out there that are dicks on the field and definitely dicks
right.
off
You
the
just gotta let them play their part,
field.
but
Exactly.
No, and I again, I appreciate the kind words and letting me be on this podcast, and I've definitely enjoyed talking to you about paintball and just anything really.
Hell yeah. Well, I think that's a good place to stop the conversation, and I don't want it to stop here. I'd love to have more podcasts throughout the year with you. I'd love to chat
No,
with
of
you
course.
more throughout the season, and I wish you the best of health, the best of luck, except for when you play us, and
Respectfully,
respectfully. But yeah, man, I love to see you out there killing it, and I enjoy playing against you.
Awesome.
Yeah. All right, man. Well, I will see you. Shit, what is it, like 3 weeks now?
Yeah, 3 weeks.
So I will safe travels until then,
Of course.
and good luck, man. I'll talk to you soon, right?
Thank you, Carl.
All right,
Appreciate
man.
it, man.
We'll see ya.
Have a good one.
Thank you so much, Alex, for joining me on this podcast. I had a great time. That was an awesome conversation. I'm so glad that he was able to make some time and sit down and chat with me. And I can't wait to play him throughout the year. The guy is one of the best, and I really enjoy going head to head with him. So thank you, Alex, so much, and we will see you soon. Thank you to Planet Eclipse for sponsoring this podcast. They are the makers of the sweetest paintball markers on the planet. The LVR, the CS1, all those goodies you can find over at planeteclipse.com. Thank you, Planet. Also, a big thank you goes to Midwest Clothing. They are the makers of some sweet Midwest gear, but they can make it for anybody. That's the sweetness about Midwest Clothing, LLC.com. They can hook you up. Thank you, Midwest Clothing. Thank you to Ventrition for making some awesome paintball supplements. They are in Cleveland, which is very convenient because anytime he wants me to test something out, it's like a one-day ship. So it's pretty cool. So thank you to Vantrition.com for helping me out. Also, thank you to Carbon over at CarbonPaintball.com. They have the sweet base layer, but they also have jerseys, gloves, a very, very popular and cool pack. So make sure you go check them out at CarbonPaintball.com. And a big thank you goes to Todd and the whole Raza Life family over there for sponsoring this podcast. They have all kinds of custom gear for you and for your team at RazaLife.com. Thank you, guys. Please do not forget to subscribe over on iTunes, on SoundCloud. I am on YouTube as Carl Markowski. My Facebook page is actually, you can find both the Playing On podcast and myself on my Facebook page is Carl Markowski, Carl Microwave Markowski, and the Playing On podcast, as well as Instagram. You can find us over there. Instagram is C Mark Kizzle and the Playing On podcast for all the cool updatedness of the guests and life and all that good stuff. So thank you guys so much for joining me, and I really had a good time. I enjoy doing these things, and I cannot wait to to do more. And I have guests lined up, so it's going to be a great year. And you guys, thank you, thank you, thank you for listening. I really appreciate it. And we will see you next time on the Playing On Podcast. See you guys.